Hi, my name's Colin Smith, and welcome to HDR and Photoshop CS5. This is actually the second edition of my best-selling HDR video. We sold a lot of copies of the first one. And what I want to do is pick up some of the stuff that we've done in the first video, but also take it a little bit further. Don't worry, if you're a complete beginner, this video is going to be perfect for you. You're going to learn all about HDR. And if you have a little bit more experience, you're also going to learn some new things. I want to share some of the new things that I've learned since the last video that I created about 3 or 4 years ago. And so even if you're advanced, there might be a couple of things that you're going to pick up here. But first of all, let's talk about HDR. What is HDR? HDR is the ability to capture the entire dynamic range of a scene. For example, with our eye, when we look around a room or we look at a particular scene, we have the ability to see a lot of detail in the shadows. And at the same time, we can still see a lot of detail in the highlights. For example, say I'm inside a room, and you're in a room right now. Have a look around. What's the darkest thing you can see in this room right now that you can still see some detail? In my case, it's the carpet. I have this dark carpet, and I can still see the detail. I can see the fluff. I can see the grain structure. I can make that out, no problem at all. Now, look at the brightest part of your room, or wherever you are. In my case, I'm looking at a stucco ceiling. This is a white ceiling, but yet I can still see detail. I can see some shadows coming off the shape of the stucco. I can actually see the texture there. Now, if I was to take my camera, I would be able to capture that texture quite nicely, but the problem is everything else in the room, or at least half my room where I am, would become very, very dark, and most of the detail would be lost in all the shadows and the dark areas of the room. Now, if I was to take that same camera, and I was to slow down my shutter speed a little bit, and expose for the darkness in the carpet, I could bring out that nice detail in that carpet, but a lot of things in the room, the detail would be blown out. The midtones and the whites would be gone, and they'd just be blown out to complete white, and all that detail would be lost. So obviously what I'm trying to say here is that the human eye is able to decipher a much greater dynamic range, and dynamic range meaning from dark to light, than your camera can. In the future, I'm sure cameras will start to take advances in dynamic range and eventually be able to capture high dynamic range on the sensor. But until that day, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be merging multiple exposures together to create HDR images. For example, let's look at this image right now in front of us. Here we have a photograph that I shot in Chicago. Now, if I was to do a standard photograph of this, this powerful dynamic sky really, to me, makes a lot of this shot. If I was to set my exposure for the sky and these clouds, the building would be very, very dark and most of the detail would be lost. Maybe these windows here where the light's coming out, these might show. Maybe a little bit of where the light's hitting the side of the building. But a lot of the rest of the building, especially the sky bridge here, all the detail would be lost here and we wouldn't really see a lot of that. Now, if I was to set my exposure for the building to bring out the detail, the sky would be blown out. It would be, at best, a light gray. At worst, it would be blown out to white. I'm sure you've taken plenty of photographs like that and probably being frustrated with that, which is one of the reasons that I personally started doing HDR about 5 or 6 years ago. I just wanted to be able to capture that nice clouds, you know, this nice detail in the clouds here and in the building simultaneously, and just bring out the punch in a photograph. So the way we do that is we actually put together a 32-bit image. Right now we're looking at an 8-bit image, and we could also be looking at this in 16-bit and you wouldn't actually notice any difference on your screen. Now 32-bit cannot be displayed on the screen all at once. So what it does is actually creates more dynamic range into that photograph than can be displayed by the screen. And don't worry if that doesn't make sense, we'll get into this as we progress in this training. But some of the things you're going to learn in this training is how to shoot and emerge and create a 32-bit file. Then you're going to learn how to tone map these images together in different ways. For example, this one here is bordering on surrealistic. It's not a full surrealistic. I have some other photographs which are a lot more extreme. And you'll learn how to do that. And at the same time, if your goal is to create a much more natural-looking photograph and you want to Just bring out the detail in those shadows, or bring out the detail in those highlights without it looking like any post-processing was done. We'll also cover different techniques for doing that. So whatever your goal is, I hope that you enjoy what I have on this video, Photoshop and HDR. We're also going to look at some single image techniques for extending the dynamic range of a single image. And then we're also going to look at creating, not an HDR, but from a single image, we're going to be able to apply a HDR style tone mapping effect to a single image, which is a great effect. It's not HDR, but it produces the result that a lot of people are looking for when they have a single image. So there's a lot of different ground we're going to cover, a lot of different techniques we're going to cover. And so without further ado, let's jump into the training, and I hope you enjoy watching this as much as I have in creating it.